Midway Broadcasting Corporation or our participating sponsors.
We are the talk of Chicago, 1690 WVON.
Now you a fisherman, but you got a soul to save. I just been cooking that loaf. I'm about to drop in a few. Think if I call it the great, the people gonna call it the truth.
Miss Malal Rahman Rahim, brothers and sisters, you are listening to Straight Words on WVON 1690. This is the talk of Chicago. Welcome to another powerful Tuesday on the radio. This is Brother BJ Murphy, of course, our editor-in-chief of the Father Called Newspapers, the host of this show, creator, Brother Naba’a Richard Muhammad is on the line. And also, we got our other big brother, Brother James G. Muhammad, a contributing editor and former editor of the Final Call newspaper, on the line. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam, Brother BJ.
What's going on, big brothers? How y'all feeling, man?
Brother BJ, Brother James, man, I am feeling great. You know why? There's a lot of things that we could be talking about tonight. It really is. But tonight, brothers and sisters, I want you to know we're going to have a special conversation. A special really is going to end up being the whole 3 hours.
Yes, sir.
In which we are going to celebrate a man, his mission, and his impact on us as a people. And that man is the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan.
Yes, sir.
Who has been serving black people, Brother James, longer than I've been alive.
Yes, sir.
I'm 62. And so, brothers and sisters, we want you to call in. When you call in, we want you to keep it rolling because it's witness bearing time.
That's right.
Right.
So we are looking forward to, in about 20 minutes, inshallah, we're going to hear from Brother Student Minister Ishmael Muhammad, the National Assistant to the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, who's going to talk to us for about 30 minutes. Then we're going to go to a break, and we're going to have with us the great Student Minister Jamil Muhammad from the East Coast. And we're going to take your call. Matter of fact, brothers, y'all want to say something? Go ahead.
Yeah, brother, I want to, well, number one, the number is going to be 573-591-1690, but also, Brother Naba, I mean, this has been just a historic and unbelievable 2 weeks. You just celebrated 1 year anniversary on the last show, and
yes,
that was a great show, and to
right,
to your hard work, man, it's been 1 year, and
that's right.
All the obstacles, despite the, you know, the challenge of raising the funds, our listeners have stood behind you, brother, and continue to stand behind you. So we don't want them to stop doing that either by contributing to this program. But the information by the success that you have demonstrated, it proves that a voice like this is needed. And before Brother BJ jumps in, I wanted to ask you, Brother Naba, why did you have to call part of the show unapologetically Farrakhan? Why is
that? You know, Brother James, I got to be honest. We decided to brand the show Black Strong and Unapologetically Pro-Farrakhan because we see so many Negroes, so many lackeys, and so many others running away from this man, slandering this man, those who have benefited from his life and his life's work. Then we see others that want to use him as if he's some kind of political football, and they want to use him to score points with this one or that one.
Mm-hmm.
But we
stand
with him in this hour, and we wanted everybody to know very clearly. Now we
before they call, they don't have to ask.
You ain't got to ask. So if you directly and get the flamethrower, you've already been warned.
That's right.
But
you don't want to be torched.
Brother, but this man now, y'all, and his impact now. So we wanted to clearly state who we were and our faith not only in him, but our faith in the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and our faith in the God that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught us about, the great Mufti Master Fard Muhammad.
Yes, sir.
Right.
The supreme being, the right. all-wise, true, and living God, and the one that came to save us, the so-called American Negro, the black man of America who must be resurrected first. Black man and woman, I'm going to say, because we ain't going nowhere without her.
Not without.
That's right.
Not without her.
Man, did they just give you a title called Student Minister too, man?
No. I'm just trying to be a good witness bearer, man.
Good witness bearer, yes, sir.
That's right.
Because the minister said, tell the truth about him. That you know.
No, amen.
That you know. And brother, I, by Allah's grace, I'm not going to say a lot, but hey, I got enough and then some.
Uh-huh.
So for us, Brother James, and we felt like our people needed to know that there's some who stand strong with Farrakhan, man.
Right. Yeah. Come on, man. Come on. Yeah.
And if you want to be strong, stand with us. If you want to hear something more about Minister Farrakhan, if you want to learn about him, if you don't know, because we can't assume that people know, then we want you to come to those who love him as opposed to those who hate him, and they hate you too.
That's right.
Matter of fact, they hate him because he loves you.
Exactly.
And he's willing to do whatever it takes to try to save your life as we look at what the world in this country is coming to.
That's right.
And but Naba, you had a great brother standing by your side, man, when this idea sprouted. Somebody who knew radio inside and out.
Somebody James.
who got a medal on their wall talking about Hall of Fame. Somebody
Black
who don't
radio
like the internet. Black
That's
radio
right.
Hall of Fame. Somebody who don't like to mention it, but he's just a bad hush my mouth. But that's his name is Brother BJ, man. He was there.
Praise be to Allah.
And he helped to craft the presentation, bro.
Brother, he's invaluable, as are you, Brother James.
All praises.
And you know, when we started, the first person who I called and said, come on and be with us, it was you, man.
Yes, sir.
That's right,
and we thank Allah for all that you bring. All your brilliance,
beautiful,
all your experience, man, all of that.
And,
you know, since some of us like all gas, you know, sometimes we need somebody to be the brake for us. So thank you for being here. So I don't crash. Well, BJ, you want to say a few words? Or do we have other choice? Say a few words, then we'll bring his brother Smell on if he's on.
And, you know,
we got
professionals. Yes, sir, we got 13 minutes. But
go ahead, Dan.
As media professionals in the Nation of Islam, man, I'm so proud and honored to be with you brothers, the editor of the Farrakhan newspaper, former editor of the Farrakhan newspaper. It's a testament between you two that you brothers love each other so much that you could be on the air together and lift one another up. And this is a wonderful example. Ain't no envy, ain't no jealousy.
Ain't no hate.
Ain't no backbiting. Ain't no jockeying for a position, man. We all brothers.
That's right.
And we love
that's
the Honorable right. Minister Louis Farrakhan. We want to represent that's him right. And that's why that's we right. call it Black Strong, Unapologetically Pro Farrakhan. And then us coming behind the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, some of his most historic messages have been on WVON. With the great Cliff Kelly.
That's right.
And just some historic moments. And for us to be on the same airwaves, because, you know, the minister talked about how sacred the airwaves are. Mm-hmm. And brothers and sisters, I'm telling you, every time we get up here and talk to you, it's a sacred moment. And we don't take it for granted. And like we said earlier, we don't take it for granted your support of this show for 1 year last week. It just came up all of a sudden. It's amazing. But Allah blessed us to be here. So since we're here, and since we ain't going nowhere, why don't you help us continue the fight for freedom, justice, and equality on the airwaves of the city of Chicago and all around the world listening to us online. You can donate to Straight Words, go to $straightwords on Cash App, $straightwords on Cash App. Send us your donation. And also on Zelle, if you got bad. I got a Zelle the other day, brother. And I'm like seeing.
All right.
You're looking at your phone. Amen. And saying you got some money up there.
Crazy.
312-480-9775. 312-480-9775. And on PayPal, it is Let me correct myself. On PayPal, it is straightwords4@gmail.com. PayPal, straightwords4@gmail.com.
So, and brother, Yeah, there have been so many people impacted by the minister, whether they're in the nation or outside of the nation, been in and been out. But every hundreds of thousands of people in Chicago alone have been impacted, have heard his word, and their lives have been changed. Those are the people we want to have call in and just wish wish him a happy birthday. 91 years. Most of those years, the majority of those years, working on behalf of black people. And you know that's a hard
thing. Right.
That is a very difficult thing to do day in and day out, is to work for black people who can sometimes not show the appreciation or take advantage, as Brother Naba was just saying, take advantage of a man who has stood with you, defended you, and then you sidestep him. You turn your back on him. You know, that to me is like the ultimate disgrace, brother. And, you know, it's like a Judas thing, man. He's helped you.
Yes,
he's given you much of his life. He's willing to die for you. And people that we have seen who he has stood with, defended, put his life out there, and they turn around and sidestep him and do something to appease our enemy because they would denounce him. So for those who love him, we're asking him to call 773-591-1690 to wish him well, to wish him a great birth anniversary, and his family, Mother Khadija. We can't say enough about Mother Khadija.
Yes.
She
oh, my God.
So beautiful,
yes,
so beautiful and so loving,
yes,
man.
Yes.
Love her, love her, love her. So it ain't without her, the minister wouldn't be the man he is. So
that's right.
I want everybody to call in.
Yeah, you know,
a man with a promising. Go ahead, bro.
No, Brother BJ, you go. Go ahead.
No, I was about to say, you know, when you talk about the minister, a man with a promising music career that gave up everything. To follow the most honorable Elijah Muhammad. I remember him telling a story about when his family members saw him selling the paper on the street.
Yeah.
And they slapped him and said, "This is what you came, this is what you come to." And the minister took it because, you know, we were taught that, you know, in order to do this work, you got to learn how to take plenty from your people that you love, that you are here to redeem.
Yeah.
Because you can't be a bitter redeemer and redeem your people that you're mad at, you know.
Yeah.
And this man is so beautiful, a life of complete sacrifice, just like the most honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Exactly.
And we love the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan because we wouldn't be the men that we are today on this radio, brothers. I just want to say that.
Yeah.
Thank you, Minister. That's a good point.
That's a good point. Some of us, you might not want to see us on the street after dark. Or it's a lot of the people that the minister has impacted. You wouldn't want to see them on the street after dark if they were in their old lifestyle, man.
But it shows, you know. And very often, brothers and sisters, we talk about Jesus in the Bible. We hear about all these miracles he performed, and how he served the people. And then in the time of his trial, which was really a trial of his disciples and those who said they loved him, he was abandoned. I would submit to you, consider this, brothers and sisters. We see models 2,000 years ago. But perhaps that example we saw 2,000 years ago, we are seeing manifested in a man who walks among us. And so we are more than happy to be associated with him, to be students of his as he teaches us about the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and Islam and the world. So this is a beautiful thing. Look, man, I'm gonna say this real quick. I was blessed to go to Iran with the minister a few years ago. Let me say this to you. We were in one of their think tanks, right? We went to this institute.
Yes, sir.
The gentleman who hosted us was a former foreign minister and a former presidential candidate in Iran. When I tell you that the minister sat with these people, brothers and sisters, and he spoke to them like he was speaking, like he was sitting at 4855 South Woodlawn in his home. He was so comfortable, so assured. And he talked about our belief in the great Mahdi, Master Farhad Muhammad. And he said it just like that. We believe the great Mahdi has made his appearance in North America. We know him as North America. Right? And then he said, we believe in the Honorable Elijah Muhammad as Masih or Messiah. Nobody ran out of that room screaming the stuff for law. They sat there and they listened intently as the minister spoke. It was a powerful, powerful moment. It was in Iran where we were coming through the airport, and we had these books, kind of like a collection of pieces about the minister. The title of the book was Defending Farrakhan. Do you know, brothers and sisters, do you know that one of the boxes split and one of the books came out, and the Iranian said to us, what is this? Did you know that Farrakhan is one of their words? You heard of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad talking about the tribe of Shabazz? Did you know Shabazz is a name in Iran? Did you know that, or you just thought that's something he just made up? See, brothers and sisters, you need to let the slave master go, along with the white Jesus. And you need to just consider, perhaps, maybe, that you have some value in the eyes of God. Maybe 400 years of suffering has qualified you for something. Maybe you fulfill the prophecy of Abraham's seed, serving the strange people in the strange land that is not theirs. But I suggest to you, you're going to need somebody that can teach you and show you and get you an understanding. And we're blessed to have such a man in our midst, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan.
That's right.
Brothers and sisters, call on in 773-591-1690, and we're hoping the Student Minister Ishmael, he's been working really hard. I know he was traveling and stuff this weekend, so we're hoping he'll be able to join us. He's been working really hard. But you call in and give us a minute or two, because we're going to keep, our goal is to keep these calls rolling. And we want to be the news we're called, okay?
Yeah. I think I hear a background. Is it a radio on somebody? But there seems to be some background. Unless it's just my phone. Yeah.
Okay.
But you know what, Brother Naba? One thing for me that I'm, that the benefit, one benefit, small, well, one big benefit, actually, that the teachers are giving me is to take me out of the mind of that spook God. It helped me to, I mean, because all of our lives, back in the day, we were literally taught that there was a devil. I don't know if they teach it this way this much anymore in the homes, in these black homes and everything, that there's a devil in the center of the earth where there's flames and he's got these, he's red with a tail. This is literally the image that was on TV and was told. And that when you die, your soul goes to hell or heaven. Heaven was in the sky. And, you know, you can't see, you know, you, I guess you just keep going until you reach it. But you know, when I think back on it, you know, that's kind of what the Honorable Elijah Muhammad talked about, the slave teaching of the slave master, to keep our head up in the sky while he enjoys heaven on earth while he lives. We have a continent without which the world couldn't operate that's under the feet of black people. Yet we benefit nothing or very little from it. And the mineral resources that are taken out of it are taken and developed in the so-called developed world, taken and sold all over the world and even back to the people in the land where the resources come from at a higher price. And so that's what the teaching to me represents, is our unity to overthrow this wicked ruler that has been taking over the lives of the people of the planet, you know, of all people, of all oppressed people. That's been one of the greatest things for me that I benefit from the teaching.
Yes, sir. We got Brother Omar on the line, and we're waiting Minister Ishmael, National Assistant to the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, to call in, brother, this hour. But right now, let's go to the phone lines at 773-591-1690. You're on WVON, Straight Words, Brother Omar. Assalamu alaikum.
Hey, wa alaikum salam. This is Omar Muhammad. I'm related to James G. Muhammad, I believe.
Yes, sir.
Brother Lieutenant. One of Naba's distant relatives, too, distant nephew, too. I just wanted to call and tell him, you know, me and your grandson Ryan listening to the radio show, but we wanted to wish the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan a happy 91st birthday on Saturday. And I thank Allah for him, you know, because he's so instrumental in my life personally. And I just, you know, wish that everybody could listen to him and give him an ear. And how hard, like he was saying earlier, how hard it is to be on a mission and dedicated for 70, I don't even know how many years, almost 70 years. The mission, man. So I salute the minister. I thank Allah for him. He is one of the greatest influences in my life, you know, along with my pops as well. So,
praise be to Allah.
Everybody. Love all y'all.
Yes, sir.
Yes, I love you too, so.
Thank you, sir. Right, I would add to that, though, brother. I believe the minister probably, I'm sure he has been a greater influence to Omar than myself, as I tried to give Omar, you know, the basics, but the minister developed everything and pulled more of it out of him, as he did with me and my father, you know. So, and I think it's probably true with most of us.
Yes, sir. Well, the moment has arrived, Brother Naba. We got Brother.
Quick.
We're gonna take Art.
And then we'll go to Brother Ishmael, so we can go uninterrupted. So let's do about a minute or two, and let's keep moving.
All right, Brother Art, you're on WVON on Straight Words. Go right ahead, sir.
Hey, assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam.
You know, I'm going to always start off with God, the black man, the black woman, and black children. It is all about rebuilding and restrengthening the black family and the black community. I believe we all stand on the shoulders of someone before us. The question is, are we going to take the principles that the individuals have taught us and move forward with this, or with the principles? So I will agree that the teachings of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad and many other men, but specifically has awakened a lot of different things. And I think that we have to refocus ourselves back on rebuilding and re-strengthening the black family. And I hope and pray that the leaders and teachers come together in community to help collectively build the community code of conduct and the family value system that's universal, that don't matter what institution in our community we go to, that the same page and same book, when you open it up, it's the same program to help strengthen and rebuild our family and our community. But I leave it there, and I will hopefully hear the brother speak. Thank you.
All right, Brother Art. Thank you. Let's bring in that somebody. I think you're right, Brother James. I'm hearing the radio in the background. So somebody, if you can mute your phone, and we want to bring in Student Minister Ishmael Muhammad, who serves as the National Assistant to the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. And brothers and sisters, if you are in the city of Chicago, you can hear him
just about every Sunday live in person, 7351 South Stone Island Avenue, 10 o'clock. And if you can't see him live, you can see him at NOI.org. Assalamu alaikum, Brother Ishmael. Welcome to the program. Thank you for joining us.
Wa alaikum salam, Brother Naba. Thank you for having me. It's such a great honor and privilege to be on this great, great show, WVON, with your co-host, Brother BJ. And I'm very, very happy and excited to join the many callers and you as we give thanks to first and foremost Allah God for this wonderful human being, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, and our thanks to him for what he has done, is doing, and will continue to do on behalf of our suffering people and suffering humanity. Thank you for having me on the show.
You know, Brother Ishmael, I know you've been working and traveling and being about your business. You know, can you just share your experience with the minister? Is there anything, because I think we all who've been blessed to come into contact with him, there are ways that he impacts us. And a lot of times, I know for me, it's kind of, in a sense, it's difficult for me to share some of the personal stuff because I don't want it to seem like I'm with him because he gave me something. He gave me, by Allah's grace, a whole new life, way of thinking.
That's right.
He opened up me. He opened me up to being the best manifestation of who I was. But this has been a kind man, brothers and sisters, who has helped me when I was sick. Let me just bear witness. So where Jesus helped the sick, where Jesus helped the poor, where Jesus helped those that didn't have help nowhere else, that man has done that for me. But he gifted me with knowledge. He gifted me with an example. He healed my heart after being estranged from my father because I heard him teach over video, audio tape. I'm sorry, Brother Ishmael. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, you don't have to apologize. You have a testimony to give to the world. On what that beautiful man has done for you personally. He didn't manifest from you the best man that you were. He manifests from you and me and us the best of ourselves. And in the church, I didn't grow up in the church, but they tell me that there's a song, and there's a great artist who sings this song, and in that verse, you know, when everyone looked at the worst in me, and it's a song about Jesus, but he saw the best in me. So your personal testimony and the personal testimony of tens and millions of people, as it was said on this show earlier, not just those of us who have become registered members of the Nation of Islam, the minister has spoken to the multitudes, and millions of lives have been changed for the better because of the word that God put in his mouth for us. And there are millions who follow the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and what the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan has taught us about God, about being the best of who we are. So no apology is necessary, Brother Naba, because you walk with the man. You've talked with the man. You've supped with the man. You've worked right underneath him. Not past tense. You work underneath this man. So who are his best witnesses to the world? The person that comes to a Savior's Day message, the person that heard him at a church, the person that heard him at some event. But everyone wants to know, is the man that I see in front of me, what is his personal life? Who is he after he gets down from the rostrum? Is he the same man that appears in the public? Is he the same man privately? And we answer, yes. Farrakhan is authentic. Farrakhan, what you see is absolutely what you get. Exactly. Not just in the public, but all the time. So when you ask me the question to share from my personal relationship with him, I feel like you in this sense. I don't share a lot of my personal interactions or conversations with the minister because I don't want people to think that my relationship with him is more important than anyone else. But the scripture says, to whom much is given, much is required. And I have received much good and love from him personally. So it's my duty, as you said. I know you're going about doing your business. Well, it's not my business. It's the Lord's business. It's the Father's business. It's the business of the resurrection of our people. And I would not be where I am today as a son of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad if it were not for Minister Farrakhan. And when my father departed, Brother Naba and Brother BJ and those who are listening, in 1975, I grew up with hope, with a dream, expectations that I would help my father in the ministry. And he put me on that rostrum at 7351 South Stony Island, Mosque Mariam, which was called in those days Temple Number 2. And I spoke as an 8-year-old boy 2 or 3 times. He had me write as a little boy in the Muhammad Speaks newspaper. And I wrote an article that he featured called The Resurrection. But when the nation fell, I, like so many others, was devastated, and everything that we had hoped for, everything that we were looking to, was all gone. So after the nation fell, that dream went with that. And I had no more aspirations or dreams of being a minister, because there was no nation, there was no Elijah Muhammad. But when my blessed mother, Mother Tynetta, she loved the minister, and she, like so many others, we knew that Minister Farrakhan was the one that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad had confidence in, and we expected him to be in the seat leading our nation. but circumstances would have it otherwise. And so one day, Brother Naba, my mother heard that the minister had decided to rebuild the nation. And that was in 1977. It was in the winter of 1977, I believe, shortly after he stood up in September of that year after his meeting with Brother Jibril, may Allah be pleased, in California. And my mother went immediately to his home on 9415 South Damon. And I accompanied her, and she went to pledge her support for him and his effort and desire to rebuild the nation of Islam. As a young teenager, after the meeting with the minister, and I'll never forget this, my mother and I got back in the car, and she was so excited, and she said, "Well, Ishmael, what do you think? What do you think? The minister's going to rebuild the works of your father." And I said, "Oh, I don't know." In my little mind, I'm like, I don't know how this man is going to pull this off.
He did.
And then I saw him again in 1978. He visited the Bay Area, and he spoke at the Your Black Muslim Bakery. And I was so drawn to him. And I loved him so much because of first his humanity. And most of us fall in love with Minister Farrakhan, not because of the strength of his voice, not because of his charisma that attracts the ear to him, but we see a tender-hearted man, a man full of compassion. These are the qualities that draw human beings to each other. It's the quality of the heart. And no matter what good words come from a man or a woman's lips, it's the character of the person that matters. It's the heart of the person that matters. And with Minister Farrakhan, people can feel that this man is sincere. He's good, good-hearted, through and through. So I was drawn to his humanity. I said, "Boy, this is a beautiful man." Of course, I met him and knew him when the Honorable Elijah Muhammad was here, and I saw him when he came to the National House called the Palace at 4855 South Woodlawn. I was just a little shorty, and I was admired him then as a little boy of just the beauty, his smile, his face, and always lit up and full of energy. And every time he would lift the name of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, nothing but love. So, brother, from 1978, once I saw him, and then I was in Phoenix and with Brother Jibril, and the minister invited me or asked my mother if he could take me to Washington, D.C., where he was scheduled to speak at the from Howard University Theater in D.C. And my mother gave permission. I went to D.C. And when I was sitting in that theater, they gave me, I think it was a third or fourth row seat. I was right in the middle. And as the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan was delivering his message, I saw him transfigured, transposed, and I could see my father coming through him. And I squint my eyes, I rub them. I wasn't doing drugs at that time, Brother Naba. I was DJ, I was pretty clean then.
Yes, sir.
I know as I said then, because at a certain point did dip and dab. So I wasn't under the influence of anything. And I'm telling you, I saw the Honorable Elijah Muhammad come through him. And it was like my father saying, I am with him, son. I am with Farrakhan. And my heart was so comforted. And when that lecture was finished and he went to his room, I was with Joshua. May Allah be pleased.
May Allah be pleased, yes.
And when he went to his suite, and went to his room, and as soon as the door opened, he was laying in the bed under the covers, lying on his back, and I ran to him, and I just put my whole body on him, chest to chest, because I knew this is the man of God and the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And from that moment to this day, I have never doubted Minister Farrakhan is Allah's servant among us. That beautiful man, I've had many conversations. We've traveled alone many times on the plane, just him and I, and in the car. And so I have been very blessed, Brother Naba, to have many personal conversations, personal situations that has really, really benefited me. But as I said, puts a great responsibility on me. And I think, Brother Naba, that's why I speak with a lot of passion sometimes, maybe most of the time, with a lot of spirit. Because my teacher, my father here on earth, I always wanted a relationship, like you said, Brother Naba, with my father. And I was hurt that I could not have enjoyed a son-father relationship with my father. And I always wanted to shadow him. You know, I wanted to be able to see how he does what he does and walk with him. And little did I know at that time that Allah would bless me to watch my father work in the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan in this great work that he has been doing 49 years absent his teacher, 69 years from 1955, and he'll be 91 on Saturday. So his whole life has been devoted, not just the mission of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and I say it like that to say this. This is a man who, when he was a little boy, he had a burning in his heart to relieve the pain and suffering of his people. From a little boy, he wanted God to use him to uplift his people. He's not a man that has developed that kind of heart as a result of him meeting Elijah Muhammad. God gave him that heart. His whole constitution is from God. He's from God for God. So we are blessed beyond words. And to think, Brother Naba, Brother BJ, brothers and sisters, we have been blessed with many great leaders and teachers and luminaries. And many of those that God blessed us with, they didn't stay with us long. They did a tremendous work. Some of them were killed, some of them assassinated, some of them with failing health. But when you look at the longevity, the span of Louis Farrakhan in our liberation struggle, no leader has been at the point and has been in this struggle as long as Louis Farrakhan.
Wow.
Name me one. There isn't one. And to be blessed that we still have him, and he will be, Allah willing, 91 years of age and still kicking, raising hell, no, raising heaven and condemning hell, as we heard him in Detroit at Savior's Day of this year. This continued strength, the uncompromising voice of Louis Farrakhan. He has been, he is one of a kind. And his teacher said that of him, brother, you have no equal. Brother Farrakhan has done a work that's worthy of our support, worthy of us giving thanks to Almighty God Allah for him. Thanks to the Honorable Elijah Muhammad for him. And thanks to him for the sacrifice that he makes. I could go on, Brother Naba, but you know, as you are proving your love. See, I was thinking about you, Brother Naba, and I'll close. I know you got probably callers that want to ask questions and share their stories, but I was thinking about you, Brother Naba, and the beauty of your heart. And I was thinking, look at what my brother is doing. Even though you've had health challenges, this is the proof, brother, that you are a believer. You are devoted. You are dedicated to the cause of God, man. And that's why the Quran says, keep your duty to Allah as it ought to be kept, and die not unless you are a Muslim in submission to the will of God. So in spite of your health, you have found your way whenever you have had just a little strength to be back on these airways to give a testimony of your life and give a testimony and be a witness of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. For the test is not when we're healthy. The test is not when we have the strength. The test is when we are challenged by health, challenged by circumstances, and we have that example in Brother Farrakhan. We've never heard him complain. We've never heard you complain, but the minister has not complained. And all of those years that he was in excruciating pain from the radiated seeds that were implanted in his prostate to destroy the cancer cells, but they tried to kill our brother. And it was destroying his insides, man. And when I say pain, brothers, I'm talking about pain. And he traveled all around this world 2 and 3 times in pain. He delivered lectures after lectures, 2 and 3 and 4 messages in a day, as you know, Brother Naba, going into cities, meeting with leadership, interviews with radio and television, and then a public meeting in the evening. But he never complained. That shows you and me that we have a man who's so completely devoted and dedicated. Every time that I'm with him, is always concerned over the little man, always concerned over the suffering of our people, our community. That's Minister Farrakhan.
Brother, and we thank Allah for him. We got to take a
I'm sorry, break. I just kept going.
No, that's okay. You didn't go over. 773-591-1690. This is Straight Words, paying tribute to Minister Farrakhan. Come on now. We got to take a break. Stay with us. WVON, AM 1690.
May is Health Awareness Month, and the Talk of Chicago is your primary care radio station. Healthy reminders and medical experts all month long. With no copay. Only on WVON. The Talk of Chicago and the voice of the nation is 1690 WVON, Berwyn, Chicago.
And I'm Kevin Brown on your home for 24/7 News, the Black Information Network.
Donald Trump is insinuating that he's willing to go to jail on principle.
This judge has given me a gag order and said you'll go to jail if you violate it. And frankly, you know what? Our Constitution is much more important than jail. It's not even close.
Speaking after his hush money trial recessed, Trump ripped the judge who threatened him with jail for once again violating his gag order when he talked about witnesses in the case. Trump blasted the threat of jail, saying, quote, I'll do that sacrifice any day, adding, the Constitution is more important. He said the prosecution told the judge they needed 2 to 3 more weeks to make their case. Trump said it should have already ended and that the criminal trial is politically motivated.
More on a story we told you about. Republican Congressman Mike Collins of Georgia is denouncing racism and discrimination days after he shared a video of counter-protesters at the University of Mississippi where a young white man is shown making ape-like gestures and noises while taunting a black woman. Pro-Palestinian demonstrators on the campus are seen being shouted down, and Collins praised their actions as Old Miss taking care of business, while a spokesperson said in an email that Collins shared the video as an example of counter-protesters not allowing occupiers to trash their campus. On Monday, Collins acknowledged in a social media statement that the video showed potentially inappropriate behavior that no one should seek to glorify, maintaining he did not believe that was the focal point. Meanwhile, the university is launching an investigation into student conduct.
All right, well, a woman who will become the first black mayor in Northern Ireland says racist abuse is not a deterrent. Lillian Sinoy Barr, who was selected by the Social Democratic and Labour Party as mayor of Derry and Strabane, has reported death threats. Police say a 30-year-old man was arrested over the weekend in connection with online threats, which are being treated as a racially motivated hate crime. Sinoy Barr telling BBC News it has actually made her even more determined about representation and a more inclusive and progressive society. She says it isn't about making history, it's about delivering for the people.
Vice President Kamala Harris in Detroit, Michigan, touting the Biden administration's $100 million investment in small and medium-sized auto manufacturers.
Many of which are black-owned and based right here in Michigan.
The Energy Department's Automotive Conversion Grant Program is receiving $50 million. And another $50 million is earmarked for Industrial Assessment Center implementation. Republican Congressman John James criticized the funding, saying the government needs to repeal harmful regulations that threaten the automotive industry with tens of billions of dollars in more fines and send jobs to Mexico and China.
Deirdre Mathis is a force in the hospitality industry, opening the first black-owned hostel in the United States and creating the first black-owned hotel in Houston, Texas. Mathis launched Wanderstay Hospitality Group in 2018, and since then, at least 30,000 guests have enjoyed the properties. She has now joined an accelerator program to be completed next month, which provides U.S. and Canada-based black entrepreneurs with capital resources, mentorship, and education. I'm Terry McCready along with Kevin Brown on your home for 24/7 News, the Black Information Network.
Ladies, if you have been told you have dense breast tissue, ask your doctor the advantages of having an ultrasound versus a regular mammogram. That's your healthy reminder.
Hey, Alexa, play WVON 1690 AM.
Getting WVON 1690 AM station from iHeartRadio.
Try it out for yourself. America is listening to WVON.
Hi, it's Tavis Smiley inviting you to join me weeknights, 6 to 9 p.m. right here on WVON. I'll bring a national perspective to all things happening in Black America. It's talk the way you like it, and it's why America is listening.
It's the legendary Tavis Smiley, weeknights at 6 p.m. on the Talk of Chicago, 1690 WVON.
Have you checked out WVON's digital streaming network, Bon TV? It's everywhere on Roku, Apple TV Plus, Amazon Fire, on the WVON app, and at VON.TV. Bon TV, it's cultural content on purpose.
What's up, Chicago? This is BJ Murphy.
This is Naba'a Richard Muhammad.
Tune in Tuesdays, 9 p.m. to 12 midnight on WVON 1690, the Talk of Chicago.
And we're streaming live on iHeartRadio and WVON.com. So again, that's Tuesday night, Central Time, 9 p.m. to midnight. It's Straight Words with Naba'a Richard Muhammad and
Brother BJ Murphy.
And we are Black, strong, and unapologetically pro-Farrakhan.
I'm Selma, and I'll be your server this evening. The special is pasta primavera, and it comes with a salad. Oh, and by the way, I abuse my children. Lots of times, I beat them for even the smallest reason. When they really get on my nerves, I lock them in the closet for a few hours.
If only child abuse was this easy to recognize. Perhaps then more people would report it. If you even suspect abuse, call Child Help at 1-800-4-A-CHILD. Or visit www.childhelp.org. We've helped millions of people help millions of children, and we can help you. All calls are anonymous and confidential. So remember, 1-800-4-A-CHILD, or visit www.childhelp.org. Child Help. Trust your instincts. A public service message brought to you by Child Help and the Ad Council.
Alexa, play WVON 1690 AM.
Getting WVON 1690 AM station from iHeartRadio.
Try it out for yourself. America is listening to WVON.
The following is paid programming. The views are not necessarily those of this station.
We are the Talk of Chicago, 1690 WVON.
See, if you can't speak straight words, you will never be successful with God. You can't be a double-talking, double-dealing, hypocritical human being and be right in the sight of God. You must speak straight words.
Go ahead. WVON 1690, the Talk of Chicago. You got to talk straight words. That's the program we're on every Tuesday night from 9 to midnight right here on WVON, the Talk of Chicago. Brother Naba'a Richard Muhammad, Brother James G. Muhammad, yours truly, Brother B.J. Murphy. And it's the 91-year anniversary, the birth anniversary of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Coming up on this Saturday, we're doing a special show. And we've got some invited guests, people going to be calling in from all over the country. Right here to WVON. You can join the conversation tonight as well, 773-591-1690. But right now, Brother Naba'a, Brother James G., we're going to continue our conversation with the National Assistant to the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, our great, great helper of his, yes. Minister Ishmael Muhammad. Go ahead, Brother Minister.
Yeah, and Brother BJ, we've been joined by Brother Jamil Muhammad, student yeah. minister as well.
Go ahead.
That great preacher, Jamil.
So, Brother BJ,
yes,
before
sir.
We get back to our great brothers and witness bearers and man, champions and soldiers in Islam, let's tell the people how they can help us continue to help the man that we love.
That's right. Brothers and sisters, we got straight words. We've been on for 1 year, and we want your continued support. We thank you so much because it is your dimes, nickels, and quarters and dollar bills that help us stay on the air. So we thank you so much of what you've done and what you're going to do in the future. Straight Words on Cash App, $Straight Words on Cash App, on Zelle. You can hit us at 312-480-9775, 312-480-9775. And on PayPal, it is straightwords4@gmail.com. We thank you, brothers and sisters. Make sure y'all donate before you go to bed tonight right here on WVON 1690 with Straight Words, Brother Naba’a, Brother James G.
All right, Brother DJ. And brothers and sisters, what you just heard, that wonderful clip from a minister talking about Straight Words, that's the work of your brother, DJ Murphy, Black Radio Hall of Fame, All-Star, baby. Brother Ishmael, you were talking about, before we went to the break, the minister working through extreme, excruciating pain and never complaining. I wanted you to finish that point, and then we'd like to bring in Brother Jamil to share.
Well, I think, dear brother, the point that I was making was that we have been blessed with a man that is so devoted to the cause of freedom, justice, and equality. He's a humble man. He's a man that does not make anything of himself. And he, being the servant of God, he manifests the great qualities and attributes of God, which all of us possess these attributes, beneficence and mercy. And Minister Farrakhan does what he does, as the Quran tells us, to do good, seeking no gain.
Yeah.
And so the minister is a man who has given his life for the cause and has laid down his life to see a whole people delivered and a people freed. And he never complained.
Mm-hmm.
He always, always is giving glory and praise to God. Many of us like to complain and say what we don't have and woe is me. And that's just a man or woman whose faith in God is not what it should be. But the minister on that point has just been absolutely steadfast. Steadfast under trial. Mm. And all that he has suffered physically, all the abuse that he has suffered, being called everything imaginable. Just think, brothers and sisters, you don't know any other leader, past or present, that has been more vilified and evil spoken of than Louis Farrakhan. They hate him so much. And we know him in the Black community.
Yes, sir.
We know him as a good man and all the good that he has done. But the enemy, who does not want to see Black people united, does not want to see Black people love self and love brother and sister, this man, Louis Farrakhan, is called a hater. He's called an anti-Semite. He's called a homophobic. He's called a racist. He's called all these ugly things, falsely charged, falsely accused, lied on. But in spite of all of that, look at how he comes before us. He's a man totally unaffected by the evil words that have been said about him. So we thank Allah for him, Brother Naba, Brother BJ, and every black man and woman, whether you know him or not, one day you're going to thank God for Farrakhan. Mm. You're going to thank God for Elijah Muhammad, because these two men have brought us salvation. And as the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, Brother Naba'a, wrote in Message to the Black Man, you don't see and know what the price that is being paid for our salvation. Brother Farrakhan has paid a tremendous price to speak the truth that he speaks, and to speak straight words to power. But let us keep him in our prayers. Let us thank God for giving to us the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan.
All right. Thank you so much, Brother Ishmael. Brother Jamil, the floor is yours.
Jamil.
Ishmael, my brother. And let me tell you something,
Jamil.
Assalamualaikum. And dear listeners, I have to tell you, what you are hearing is brothers who love each other. In Arabic, they say, "Fizibi Allah," for the sake of Allah. Those of us who were taught to love each other by the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, who gave us the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and now we love each other because we know each other. Mm-hmm. I am blessed to be here tonight with my big brother, Student Minister Ishmael. But I'm here tonight with my longtime friends, and I can say this unequivocally or without pause or hesitation. Brother BJ actually put me through my paces when he was down in North Carolina, mm-hmm. and helped me to become better at the message and sharing the message in a professional way. Brother Editor Emeritus James G. Muhammad, our dear brother, and he always reminds me, and homeboy from Cincinnati. All right, homeboy. But he's always been there for the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan as a faithful witness, and his family took my family as family, and we became tighter because of Islam. My dear brother Naba'a, I remember, brother, when you first walked in the door.
Go ahead,
fired up. Fired up, filled with the spirit. And I thought to myself, I don't know why. I got to get with this brother. He keeps some energy. And he still has it, Brother Ishmael, to this very day. And so to be with my brothers and all of the listeners on WVON 1690 Chicago, I like to say it like that, you know, like I'm in radio. But it's just a great, great honor and privilege to be here with you all and to bear witness to the life, the work, and the effect, the lasting impact of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. So whatever your questions are, let's raise some questions, let's talk. And I was moved by Brother Student Minister Ishmael's comments, because all you heard in his voice, in his speech pattern, in his syntax, you heard it in his syllables and in his rhyming pentameter, his rhyme, his meter and foot, if you will.
Are you a poet?
In my brother's expression was love. And some people, when they hear us do this, brothers, you know how they get. They get to, they go off in a corner and point over at us. Look at them over there. They love Farrakhan too much.
They're right.
And I just say, for those of you who think that we do love the minister too much, I'm sorry, bub. You don't have to adjust. Because as long as the minister doesn't seek to usurp the position of Allah and the eternal leader of the Nation of Islam, the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and he most assuredly does not, then we're on safe ground.
Mm-hmm.
As long as the minister doesn't teach us the disrespect of the prophetic community in general, or the life and work of Prophet Muhammad ibn Abdullah, peace and prayers be upon him, in particular, and he does not, then we're secure in our faith and we are free from accusations of shirk or idolatry or loving anybody too much. We are Muslims. But the problem with many of you is you've never seen love like this before, so it blows your mind. Like, I get it. Like, I understand. You don't have a frame of reference for it. And since you're on the outside looking in, and I wanted to, BJ, I wanted to work in two titles of songs in one paragraph, okay? I said, didn't it blow your mind? So you heard that one, BJ. And then I said, you're on the outside looking in like Little Anthony and the Imperials. You heard that one, too. What we're talking about is the joy and the spirit of brotherhood and love. I'm a witness to it. When my brother spoke about being at the Howard Theater and getting permission to be there that day, I was in the building that same very day. It was, it was in April of 1979, Brother Minister Ishmael. That's the one you're talking about, right?
If you got the date, you know, okay, that must be the one.
Yes, it was a beautiful, sunny spring day, and I remember I brought four or five of my friends from college. I was enrolled as a student at Howard University at that time, and we went down the hill to the legendary Howard Theater, where the minister was speaking. The Howard Theater in Washington, D.C. is like the Apollo in New York, or the Uptown or in Philadelphia, or the Regal in Chicago. It's the performance venue of choice for all of the legendary black public figures. And the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan spoke there that day so beautifully. And I know you remember, Student Minister Ishmael, everyone in the house was moved. And I did not know the stirring account that you just gave of how you gazed upon the minister from the third or fourth row and you saw the visage of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad and felt the spirit of your father. And it was like he was telling you, I'm with him. You can be with him. See, to me, these confirmations are proof. Somebody once said that outlandish claims require outlandish proof. And I submit for your consideration tonight, dear brothers and listeners, that the things that make us the Nation of Islam seem outlandish. They seem outrageous. They claim the credulity of those whose minds were shaped in the institutions of the enemy. And so when you hear that God is a man, when you hear that God has prepared a defending mother wheel for us, when you hear the truth of the origin of the Caucasian on our planet, when you hear the cycles of history and the record of time, it blows your mind. But the outlandish proof of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad's truth in teaching is the fact that his minister, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, has given the world an announcement of information that he had no way of knowing, except that he got it, and I quote, from me, Elijah Muhammad, on the wheel. Farrakhan, he's the faithful witness of Muhammad. And if Farrakhan tells us something, we could be rock solid sure. If I was out in the street, I'd say you can bet your bottom dollar, but I don't bet, and I don't have a bottom dollar out there. I tell you, our Redeemer liveth. Our Redeemer liveth. And so testifies our beloved minister. Either you believe him or you don't. But all praise is due to Allah. See, Brother Ishmael, you got me all fired up. I was going to be cool tonight. I was going to be laid back.
Hey, Jamil. Brother Jamil. Can I chime in on something real quick, Brother Naba? You know, Brother Jamil, you just reminded me of something when you acknowledged our beautiful brother and the editor emeritus of the Final Call newspaper, Brother James G. Muhammad. from Cincinnati, and I
and you
was reminded that you're from Cincinnati, but you called him your homie, and you forgot I'm your homie, too, because
that's right.
Lived in Cincinnati and was raised in Cincinnati. And Rasul and Ahmed and Medea were all born in Cincinnati, so we're all homies from Cincinnati.
The homie can make sense.
You brought all the homies, DJ, and Naba, you brought all the homies from Cincinnati on the radio show tonight.
There you go. Brother, let me tell you,
that was good.
That love that you hear tonight, the enemy, and I pray a sincere dua of prayer that the enemy will wake up at 3 o'clock this morning with retching bowels, coughing up, acid from his stomach. I hope the enemy is suffering because he hates to see us in love with each other. In fact, one of the things I love about the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, you see, he doesn't just decry and condemn the evil in this world, but he leads an ever-growing force for good. We were all scattered in different places, but when the trumpet blast was sounded, we're not the ultimate ones, we're not the last ones, we're not all of them, but we were just a few who were lucky to get up early in the process that they call the rebuilding of the Nation of Islam. See, anybody can kvetch and moan and when you see what you know is wrong, but it takes a much greater man or woman to resist and hold up a higher standard. And that's the kind of man that the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan is. As we bear witness of him in these days leading up to his 91st anniversary, then we got to remember he's thoroughly immersed in the spirit of Naba'a the Muhammad.
Right.
And the most Jamil. Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
But Jamil, you mentioned that a lot of our people are kind of maybe confused or, puzzled by the love that we're showing because they haven't known this kind of love. I would suggest, too, though, that maybe they have, because when I hear our brothers and sisters in the church, they say, oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. And so when we look at the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan and we make over him and salute him and praise him in a loving brotherly way, it's because he first loved us. We wouldn't be if he had not first loved us in the way that Jesus, that the Christians say that Jesus first loved them. When Jesus comes into your life, you make a change. There's nobody on this planet that can tell me that when the minister comes into your life that you don't make a change. Not even the worst criminals that you know. When Farrakhan touches them, they change. Mm-hmm. So that's why we celebrate him. We don't look at a Jesus in the past because that may be a historical. And a lot of the tampering that the enemy has done with the Bible kind of misconstrues some of those acts that he did, though he did great works. But there's a prophetic one that's going to do the same and greater work that when you get to know him, he will change your life and bring you into everlasting life, such as how to eat to live, such as one meal a day, such as how to fast and pray. And take you out of the realm of a spook universe that you will never see or never come back to tell somebody while your enemy is changing the rules, changing the laws every day that you live and enjoying freedom, justice, and equality for himself on earth. And you sitting down praying that a change will come when you die and go to heaven in a sky that you don't even know is there. So, We got a great brotherhood because we love Jesus. Can I give you two scriptures to add to that, brother?
Brother Minister, I want you to enter and take us home on it.
And this is what we represent. Our dear brothers and sisters, we all have grown up with each other, and you have seen the transformation of your son, your daughter, your father, your mother, an uncle, an aunt, a cousin, a friend.
That's right.
The scripture says you can tell they have passed from death into life.
Into life.
Because of what? They love brotherhood. And the Quran says it like this. Remember Allah's favor to you when you were on the brink of a pit of fire.
Come on.
And he united your hearts and you became brethren. It's love of the brotherhood. It's love of self and love of each other. That's the healing that's needed in our community. That is what is keeping our brothers killing each other, robbing each other, raping our women. Look at the condition of our community. Jesus said, he who hates his brother is a murderer. So God is love. And when you have true love, you have God, and you can never have love without God. And that's what we have received. We have received the beneficence, the mercy, the favor of God.
Preach now.
And that is why we love each other. And the Jesus said it just as you said it, brother. But no. That he loved you first.
That's right.
If you and I love each other, that's because a man loved us first.
First.
And that's why we give so much thanks to Brother Farrakhan because of what he has done for each and every one of us. So let us continue, brothers and sisters, to pass from death into the real life that all of us can enjoy. We can't make that transition without love. There has be love in order for us to pass from death into life.
That's right.
That's right.
Beautiful.
Y'all got us. So look, we got me all fired up here. With we brought all the homework together, Brother Naba, BJ.
You went in the right place, but we got some callers. We got some callers we want to get in so that they can move out and other people can call in. I don't want everybody calling me tomorrow saying, Brother Nobody, you know the lines are busy all night. So let's go with Brother J.A. Salam. Then we're going to go to Cliff. Then we're going to go to Robert22X. Then we're going to go to Tommy. So y'all keep calling. You're going to get in by Lord's grace. Brother Salam, are you there?
St. Louis.
Brother Salam, you in there?
Uh-oh.
Did we lose him?
I think we might have lost him, brother.
Okay, what about Cliff? We got Cliff? You know, Cliff called every week now.
Okay, we don't know what's going on with the phone lines.
They got to let us know when they're on.
Hold on. Okay, Brother Salam just texted me. He said he's on hold. Brother Salam, speak up. Let us hear from you. Do we have to unmute him or does he have to unmute himself? What's going on? He said he's holding. Brother Salam did. He just texted me.
Okay.
Wow.
So we'll check back in with Deontay. Let's get... continue. We'll check back in with Deontay in a minute. He might have just stepped out or something going on with his with the phone lines, but we'll come right back.
Have mercy, man. Brothers and sisters, I'm really sorry about these technical difficulties because this night is for you.
Well, it's a night for the witnesses, you know, and I'm so grateful to be a witness. I'm laughing to myself as I hear my brother Student Minister Ishmael said, wow, I'm all fired up. I don't know what he expected to be. Because every time you think on something, Student Minister Ishmael, what comes out of you is what has been placed in you by Allah through the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad and cultivated under the loving hand of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan.
Right. What I'm seeing and hearing and witnessing in my brothers is a prayer walking into that studio, a prayer walking the streets of Chicago and every other city where we are being heard tonight. Yes, Baltimore. Yes, Charlotte. Yes, New York and Los Angeles, San Francisco, Oakland, wherever you are tonight. I'm asking Allah to make us believers in Him and followers of the eternal leader of the Nation of Islam, the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, helpers to the Messiah in our midst, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, because he has every right to correct us when we are wrong and even upbraid us if necessary. But he does that because, like you said, Brother Editor James, he loved us first. He looked beyond our faults. And somebody say,
there you go, there you go.
And saw our needs. When we
lifted
our voices in exasperation and said, oh, please, pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry.
Humble cry.
While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. We made a sincere prayer, even without the knowledge of the theology. Our hearts were in the place where Allah could bless us in great measure, even on our way to Islam. So I'm begging to God tonight on behalf of all of us as we work the phone lines out. Don't hang up, family. Stay with us on WVON 1690 AM in Chicago. Amen. And I implore to God tonight to just search me and whatever he has to do, just remove from me, please, dear Allah, that which displeases you.
Nothing
more than I am to staying enrolled and matriculated in this class. And you hear our brother, Student Minister Ishmael, and it looks like you got some new enrollees in the Chicago Ministry class, Brother Minister. I hear some fireballs in WBO in the studio tonight. I know you hear them.
Those songs, Brother Jamil, that you referenced, those are our cries from slavery, brother. Our ancestors,
yes, sister,
and don't pass me by. Oh, gentle Savior, and now we're living in reality that has come into fruition as the answers to those prayers. And we just got to realize that those prayers are being answered today. You know, the slave is being freed by a God who has come as he promised he would come and judge a nation that had enslaved them. And if we can't see that that's our people, that is us, then we need the glass. Mm-hmm. We need to get our glasses cleaned up, because when you open those scriptures, as Minister Ishmael does every Sunday, you can lay that scripture right over our existence here in these United States, and it fits like a glove. It ain't like if it doesn't fit, you must have quit. It fits. So you have to condemn, you know, the U.S. government and the former slave masters, and we need to be repaired. And that's the work.
Yes, sir.
That's the work of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan and the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, man.
That's
right.
All right.
So we thank Brother Ishmael for being with us, but we got to let him go. The man been traveling and working. And Brother Ishmael, give us a little something before you go. Callers, don't go nowhere. Okay? Brother Ishmael, go ahead.
Well, I can only first just thank you, Brother Naba, and our dear brother, DJ Murphy. Thank you for this show. And
thank you, sir.
It's been a year. I understand you just celebrated your anniversary of this show. And I hope and encourage all of us to support this show. The positivity that they bring to the airwaves is something that all of us need. And I encourage you, brothers, to continue to do the good work. And if those of you would like to join us Saturday at 5 a.m. Central, we are going to begin that very special and blessed day with a prayer for Minister Farrakhan and giving our thanks to Almighty God Allah for this wonderful soul, this wonderful human being. And you can join us on NOI.org
at 5 a.m. in the morning. Start your day with thanksgiving. Start your day, every day, thanking God for his many blessings. And we pray and ask Allah to continue to strengthen our minister, to give him good health and long days. And we pray for his beautiful wife, Mother Khadija Farrakhan. Live your life, brothers and sisters, with gratitude. Mm-hmm. And I hope and pray that we will support Minister Farrakhan as we should, and support each other. He's lived his whole life for black people, not just here in America, but our brothers and sisters in the Caribbean and Central South America. No one has traveled the world like Minister Farrakhan to speak to our people, to speak to the Aboriginal, and the native people of our planet. This is our time. This is our day. And we're going to go through something very difficult. As you can see, mm-hmm. the winds of war and revolution and even anarchy are all upon us now. But the minister has warned us from his teacher, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, what we are now facing around the world. So lift up your head, be encouraged, and remember everything that is happening in our world. There is the mighty hand of God that's over it all. And the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said that there would be three very difficult years, and one would be more difficult than the other. But after that, it will be over. We're in the time now of the end of the Caucasian rule on our planet. We're at the end of Satan's dominion over the people of our planet. We're at the end of this system of things. Brothers and sisters, thank you so very much, Brother Naba, for having me on the show. Thank you, Brother Jamil, for your inspiring words. Brother James, G, Muhammad, DJ, just keep doing the good work and let us continue to support the minister, help the minister, and do what we know is the right thing to do. That pleases him. That pleases God. Let us promote love of the brotherhood.
Yes, sir.
All right. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam. Okay, let's try to get Brother J.A. Salam in here. Brother Salam.
Yes, sir. Can you hear me?
We can hear you, man. Go ahead.
Praise be to Allah. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
All praise be to Allah. Being patient is very good, you know. I thank you, Brother Naba and the crew and Brother James and our dear brother for this most beautiful show that we have an opportunity to engage in. And I thank you for an opportunity to come on and to share just a few words as a witness bearer. I remember when I first came into the nation, I was born and raised in the nation. I'm third generation. My mother, MGT, my grandmother, MGT, and I'm, you know, young brother. But I thank Allah because at the age of 18, coming to the mosque as a semi-pro fighter, boxer, and I just remember those early days where it was not where we are today. I remember when we would go out and brother and I would travel. You might remember this, some of the brothers. We would travel down to Jackson, Mississippi from St. Louis and get a van load of double yolk brown eggs. And we had cases and cases of eggs. And we would come through St. Louis and drop off. And then we would come straight to Chicago and we'd take the eggs up, and the brothers would be on the streets with the eggs, because in those early days, we had to sacrifice. All we knew was we was rebuilding the nation of Islam, and it was never going to fall again. That's all. That was the only message we had. We are rebuilding the nation of Islam, and it's never going to fall again. And so we just sacrificed. We gave everything we had for a man who gave everything he had. Okay. And so we follow his example. And so to be here this many years later, over 45 years now, 46, going on 46 years, I'm grateful from a little teenage boy to be a grown man with my own teenager and grandchildren, you know, and to still be here and to be a witness to a man who never wavered, a man that never changed. You know, when you think about a person's character, when there's inconsistency of character, you have a lack of integrity. Think about that. And here's a man who's been consistent in who he is. You can't get no stronger in integrity than Minister Louis Farrakhan. Mm-hmm. And I thank Allah, because you brothers and those of the believers who are listening right now, who was chosen, I got to say, from Brother Jibril would say, you raised your hand, no you didn't. Allah raised your hand. Allah chose you for this work. Mm-hmm. You are special people at a special time to serve in this special hour. The people are in need of you. Earth, Wind, and Fire said like this. Jamil likes, you know, he does this kind of stuff. You know, shining stars for you to see what your life can truly be. Right? Jamil? That's who we are. That's who we are. Without the stars, the people in the universe, the people will go bucky. There's got to be light in the times of darkness. That's us. That's us. We are chosen for this day to bear witness to the man of this hour. And I thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, brother.
Just a few words to bear witness to the greatness of what we are today, and to stay humble, brothers and sisters. Stay together. Together is peace. Together is peace, not apart. You see, I know you see the symbol, you put your fingers up and they be apart. No, the colonizers did that to us. In our African tradition, peace was our two fingers were together. See, peace is together, not apart. It is peaceful for them for us to be separated, but it's peace for us to stay together. So I thank Allah that we, and I learned it from my 19-year-old son, may Allah be pleased, he passed away 2 years ago. That was his symbol. He always gave us peace with his fingers together. And so I spread that message to the world that peace is together, not apart. And I thank Allah that we are here together on this line, bearing witness to this great man, Farrakhan, and to the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and for the man that came by himself 9,000 miles. See, we ain't never had to travel 9,000 miles for nobody. So go around a corner to get somebody means a whole lot if you understand what your mission is. And so I'm grateful to Allah, and I thank you all for the opportunity to be a servant in this great nation and to be a witness bearer to this man and to our nation and to you. Thank you so much for an opportunity to speak. Allah bless you.
Thank you, Brother Salam. Beautiful.
Brother Salam, thank you. Let's go to Cliff. Cliff, come on in.
Assalamu alaikum, brothers, and thank you so much for taking my call. It's certainly an honor to hear the testimony coming from you brothers, particularly Brother Ishmael and his personal testimonies. And so let me say this: as a Christian, I believe in Jesus Christ, Yahweh, and that he was divine, but also that God speaks to him, you know, as a Christian in a vision. And I do believe and look at the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, even as a Christian, as the Jesus for black people today. So as the Pope is the savior for white people, you know, and the Jewish people, so-called Jews, still looking for their Messiah, I think the divine one is for us as black people. That's the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. But with that being said, I want to go back to the vision, and I want you guys to elaborate on this a little bit, brothers. that during the Savior Day speech, Minister Louis Farrakhan spoke about a vision, particularly as he had a vision about what took place with Israel. And I believe he said that according to what he mentioned, was that he saw a vision of Benjamin Netanyahu, the Prime Minister of Israel, having a meeting with the leaders of Hamas to attack his own people for the purpose of trying to commit genocide to obtain that land in Gaza. And then, so speak on that if you can. And then the second issue, this upcoming election, I believe, and Brother Ishmael said it in one of his recent messages, that we as a people should vote for God and write God opposed to either one of these candidates, Trump nor Biden. And so could you please speak on that? Those are my two points that I want to share with you brothers on this evening. And again, it's an honor and a pleasure. I'll hang up and listen to your response. Assalamu alaikum.
Well, alaikum salam. Thank you very much, Cliff. Brothers and sisters, we got a couple of lines open. Call in 773-591-1690. Very quickly, the minister didn't say he had a vision of Hamas meeting with Netanyahu. He said the Honorable Elijah Muhammad showed him the prime minister with his war cabinet, and I believe some others, and they were toasting They knew that Jewish lives would be lost.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And the minister also talked about that Benjamin Netanyahu knew about the attack before it happened. And that has been borne witness by in the New York Times, as well as The Intercept. And you can go to finalcall.com and read about that in one of my editorials. Let's go to Robert 22. Come on in, Brother Robert.
Brother, as Brother Robert comes in and we welcome him, may I drop one nugget in there with you, Brother Naba'a?
Yes, sir.
May I?
Yeah.
Let us be very, very clear. The Western world, settler colonizers, Zionists, imperialists, people who believe in ideas like manifest destiny and the Monroe Doctrine, are not above pulling off what is called a false flag operation.
Exactly.
A false flag operation is an act committed with the intent of disguising the actual source of responsibility and pinning the blame on someone else. The term false flag, you got to remember that. That's what happened in the Spanish-American War in Cuba. That's what happens with these fake activities where the tail wags the dog, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
You're looking at something, and I hope that we all got our eyes open to see. Yes, they knew, and yes, they knew they were sacrificing their own people.
All right. Brother Robert, come on in.
Sir, can you hear me, Brother Naba?
We can hear you, brother. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam, brother. It was such a tremendous information that the National Assistant to the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, Student Minister Ishmael, gave us. Brother, I'm so elated because I went to the Million Man March, which was 28 years ago. Just imagine this, brother. 28 years ago was the Million Man March. And every time the minister's present, I thank him for that Million Man March because it was so history. And I'll say this. Yet he's still constantly, with the help of Almighty God Allah, walking with us. So when Minister Ishmael made the statement to say, love you one another, even as I love you, this man has a tremendous love and patience, brother, with us. And I've benefited from him tremendously through the 8 steps of atonement, and I'm taking Dianetics as we speak. So this is to the world, and he has absolutely helped the world and humanity. So I just want to say I'm so grateful for the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan and his family, Mother Khadidra, and all of the hard work that he's done and the sacrifice that he's done, because he's changed me tremendously, me and my family. So I just want to say I'm grateful, brother, and keep up the tremendous work that you all are doing, you, B.J. Murray, Brother James, and yourself, Brother Naba. And thank you for accepting the call. And I say happy birthday, happy anniversary, to the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, who is not only the prototype of Jesus, is the Messiah in our midst, is the national representative of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, with a fourth-grade education, who mystified the scholars and scientists of this world, and we are fighting for Islam, and we will surely win.
Amen. Amen.
Go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Brother Robert. Let's bring in Tommy. Tommy, come on in.
I would like to greet you, gentlemen, and say assalamu alaikum to you.
Wa alaikum salam.
I would also like to say to the brothers and the listening audience that my name is Reverend Tommy Nelson. And I would
Reverend suggest, Nelson, thank you.
I would suggest on this evening, see, if you say that you believe in Minister Farrakhan, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, Malcolm X, Dr. King, and we do nothing that these men have said. These men are watchmen of God. They come, and the reason why people are drawn to them, the reason why they are hated, because they have tried, they have died, they have cried, and black people are still stupid as hell. And that's just the bottom line to it. And you know why they're stupid? Because they won't embrace their culture. They don't know anything about their history. And more importantly than that, as long as you live on the face of this earth, you totally are disrespecting the Honorable Minister Farrakhan to compare him to Jesus. Because the Honorable Minister Farrakhan wants nothing more than his people to wake the hell up. That's what he wants. That's why he's 91 and still alive. How can you be so blind to what is clearly evident? Because, first of all, the word says, who can speak and have it happen if God has not ordained it? The minister is ordained by God. Come on, people. You sitting up here talking, I don't give a damn about Israel and Palestine. And you know why? Because none of you ever mentioned the name of Menachem Begin. Menachem Begin put the political organization of Hamas. I said this 1,000 times. I was dumb enough, gentlemen, to go to the National Archives. I was blessed to have a father who was in World War II. He was a Red Ball Express driver. And I want you guys to hear me clearly. I was working at Michael Jordan Restaurant. I know you know where it was because it was down on LaSalle Street. And if you're 40 years old or 30 years old, whatever the hell it is, I'm 71, man. I've been around here a lot longer than you. I know all the lies. Watch this, guys. Explain this to me. So some stuff jumps off over there in Israel and Palestine. Is that not right? And obviously, yes, everybody is not, everybody's not involved in it, brother. Now watch this. They knew that those people were innocent, that the Palestinian people were innocent. They knew it. But the Palestinian people carried the sins because they would not listen to their Arab neighbors. And even while they would not listen to their Arab neighbors, because Palestine had no standing army, navy, or whatever the hell else to fight back, they thought that the best route for them was to go to NATO and your boy Truman. And guess what they came up with? They came up with the Zionists known as the Israelites that are over there. You got to understand, Zionists is the same thing as MAGA. Same thing as white supremacists, same thing as skinheads, same thing as Nazis. And the Arab nations over there told the Palestinian people, now the Arab nations, they ain't without fault. Because it wasn't like they was treating the Palestinian people with the respect that they were supposed to. And God bless the Palestinian people because they had the heart of God enough to say, hey, come by living water. And what did them people go over there and do? What have they been doing ever since Israel stepped foot in over there in Palestine, trying to
to take over the whole damn thing. That's the very thing that
the Arab nation told them they were going to do. And so guess what, guys? How can you be so blind to the fact that the Palestinian people are trapped between these forces, one way in, one way out, and they close it, and you're supposed to be world powers, and y'all ain't got enough to say, hey, man, stop this. I don't care what the hell y'all over there. Y'all want to kill each other, kill each other. But all them people over there, y'all letting them out. And how do you kill world food people who's over there just feeding people? And then watch this, guys. Because, see, this is how you know when Negroes are just totally off their rocker. Because Israel released a statement and said that they told the Palestinian people, y'all better move around because we're coming over there to destroy some stuff. Now, watch this. Hey,
Pastor Tommy, thank you. We're coming on the top of the hour. We're going to have to let you go. Thanks for calling in.
That's my very point, brother.
All right. So, brothers and sisters, we're coming to the top of the hour. 773-591-1690. But look, we want you to do this. Help us keep going and doing what we're doing. Give your donation tonight. $STW if you got Cash App, $STW. You got Zelle, 312-480-9775 on Zelle. 312-480-9775 on Zelle. PayPal, StraightWords4@gmail.com. StraightWords4@gmail.com. We'll be back. This is Straight Words. Brother Daniel, don't go nowhere, baby. We're coming back to you. You're listening to WVON AM 1690. Let's roll.
May is Health Awareness Month, and the Talk of Chicago is your primary care radio station. Healthy reminders and medical experts all month long.
With no copay.
Only on WVON.
The Talk of Chicago and the voice of the nation is 1690 WVON, Berwyn, Chicago.
Did you know that you can reduce the impact of diabetes on your life by limiting foods that are high in saturated fats or trans fats, like fried foods and baked goods? That's your healthy reminder.
Hey, Alexa. Play WVON 1690 AM.
Getting WVON 1690 AM station from iHeartRadio.
Try it out for yourself. America is listening to WVON.
Have you checked out WVON's digital streaming network, Bond TV? It's everywhere on Roku, Apple TV Plus, Amazon Fire, on the WVON app, and at VON.TV. Bond TV, it's cultural content on purpose.
What's up, Chicago? This is BJ Murphy.
This is Naba'a Richard Muhammad.
Tune in Tuesdays, 9 p.m. to 12 midnight on WVON 1690, The Talk of Chicago.
And we're streaming live on iHeartRadio and WVON.com. So again, that's Tuesday night, Central Time, 9 p.m. to midnight. It's Straight Words with Naba'a Richard Muhammad and
Brother BJ Murphy.
And we are Black, Strong, and Unapologetically Pro-Farrakhan.
Tune in every Wednesday night at 9 p.m. for Speak On It with Dr. Kofi Malik. You've seen him on cable TV. Now hear his spirited conversation on The Talk of Chicago. The question at hand is raising voices of the Negro. That plain and simple. Tune in every Wednesday night at 9 p.m. for Speak On It with Dr. Kofi Malik on The Talk of Chicago, 1690 WVON.
And I'm Kevin Brown on your home for 24/7 news, the Black Information Network.
Donald Trump is insinuating that he's willing to go to jail on principle.
This judge has given me a gag order and said you'll go to jail if you violate it. And frankly, you know what? Our Constitution is much more important than jail. It's not even close.
Speaking after his hush money trial recessed, Trump ripped the judge who threatened him with jail for once again violating his gag order when he talked about witnesses in the case. Trump blasted the threat of jail, saying, quote, I'll do that sacrifice any day, adding, the Constitution is more important. He said the prosecution told the judge they needed 2 to 3 more weeks to make their case. Trump said it should have already ended and that the criminal trial is politically motivated.
More on a story we told you about. Republican Congressman Mike Collins of Georgia is denouncing racism and discrimination days after he shared a video of counter-protesters at the University of Mississippi, where a young white man is shown making ape-like gestures and noises while taunting a black woman. Pro-Palestinian demonstrators on the campus are seen being shouted down, and Collins praised their actions as Ole Miss taking care of business, while a spokesperson said in an email that Collins shared the video as an example of counter-protesters not allowing occupiers to trash their campus. On Monday, Collins acknowledged in a social media statement that the video showed potentially inappropriate behavior that no one should seek to glorify, maintaining he did not believe that was the focal point. Meanwhile, the university is launching an investigation into student conduct.
All right, well, a woman who will become the first black mayor in Northern Ireland says racist abuse is not a deterrent. Lillian Sinoy Barr, who was selected by the Social Democratic and Labour Party as mayor of Derry and Strabane, has reported death threats. Police say a 30-year-old man was arrested over the weekend in connection with online threats, which are being treated as a racially motivated hate crime. Sinoy Barr telling BBC News it has actually made her even more determined about representation and a more inclusive and progressive society. She says it isn't about making history, it's about delivering for the people.
Vice President Kamala Harris in Detroit, Michigan, touting the Biden administration's $100 million investment in small and medium-sized auto manufacturers.
Many of which are black-owned and based right here in Michigan.
The Energy Department's Automotive Conversion Grant Program is receiving $50 million. And another $50 million is earmarked for Industrial Assessment Center implementation. Republican Congressman John James criticized the funding, saying the government needs to repeal harmful regulations that threaten the automotive industry with tens of billions of dollars in more fines and send jobs to Mexico and China.
Deirdre Mathis is a force in the hospitality industry, opening the first black-owned hostel in the United States and creating the first black-owned hotel in Houston, Texas. Mathis launched Wanderstay Hospitality Group in 2018, and since then, at least 30,000 guests have enjoyed the properties. She has now joined an accelerator program to be completed next month, which provides U.S. and Canada-based black entrepreneurs with capital resources, mentorship, and education. I'm Terry McCready, along with Kevin Brown, on your home for 24/7 News, the Black Information Network.
Got a three, got a two, got a one.
Yes!
Tune in Friday, 9 to midnight for The Fundamentals, where I, Titus T. Dub Williams, bring the mental.
Thanks, Captain Obvious.
And I, DJ Turbine Arturo Garza, bring the fun.
Are you not entertained? Is that why you're here?
So if you want some wacky,
some good conversation,
but some fun,
and a little serious,
for all your sports needs, tune in to The Fundamentals.
Friday nights, 9 to midnight. See you there.
You like that? You like that?
Hey, Alexa, play WVON 1690 AM.
Getting WVON 1690 AM station from iHeartRadio.
Try it out for yourself. America is listening to WVON.
The following is paid programming. The views are not necessarily those of this station.
We are the talk of Chicago. 1690 WVON.
Brothers and sisters, welcome back. WVON 1690, the talk of Chicago. It's the Straight Words with Brother Naba'a Richard Muhammad, Brother James G. Muhammad, Brother B.J. Murphy. We're here every Tuesday night, 9 p.m. to midnight, right here on WVON 1690, the talk of Chicago. Join the conversation tonight. We are talking about the 91st birth anniversary of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, which is taking place on May the 11th, this Saturday. And we got some special guests on the line. Brother Jamil Muhammad is on the line with us, and we got some more special guests with our Brother Naba'a and Brother James G. and myself. So, brothers and sisters, this has been an electric night, and let's continue the conversation, Brother Naba'a and Brother James G. and Brother Jamil. What we got?
All right, let's bring in Brother Daniel, and if you want to get in and express yourself, 773-591-1690, call on in. Brother Daniel, you there?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
All praises due to Allah. I want to thank Allah for Student Minister Ishmael, our great brother Jamil, Brother BJ, Brother Naba'a, and the great brother James. it's an honor to bear witness to what Almighty God Allah is doing through the minister for not just us who are registered in the Nation of Islam, but for all the people of the planet Earth. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said, through you, Brother Minister, I would get all of my people. And the minister said in his Savior's Day that no servant of God thinks of himself as more valuable than the people that he has been raised to save. And my testimony tonight is that the teachings of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad coming through the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan has did for me what is said in the Bible. Be ye not conformed to this world's life, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind.
Yeah.
I've been in the Nation almost 27 years, and I bear witness that I'm not the same old Negro that I was 25 years ago. Mm-hmm. I see a demonstrative, actionable change in my thinking and in my actions, and I completely correlate that to what I'm studying of the teachings, the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad books, the 21 study guides of self-improvement, the basis for community development, the teachings, the thousands of messages that the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan has given, and his exemplary example, his sublime morals and character that he is showing us. I remember listening to the minister when I first came into the Nation, and this thought hit my mind. Is this man living what he's teaching? I'm being honest. And I lied to you, not the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan said, this life can be lived.
That's right.
Whoa. Oh, did he hear me? But in me striving, and I fall short. You're going to fall short in this world. This is Satan's world. But I bear witness that what is coming through the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan has absolutely stood me up, stands me up, and when I fall down, I get right back up, and I stay right there in the fight, not just for me.
Mm-hmm.
I'll close with this. The Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan is being used by Allah to teach in such a way where he's putting love in us for all of God's people. All of them. Especially the black man and woman, but not just that, humanity. This is why we were asked. Have compassion for those in the Middle East, because what's going on over there is being planned for us. And it will soon be at our doorstep. So here's a man telling us from God how we need to clean up our mind, heart, and soul and bow down and get ourselves ready for our own trials and tribulations that's coming. And the last thing is, I remember the Savior's Day message and the title, What Does Allah God? The Messiah, I mean, the Mahdi and the great Messiah have to say about the war in the Middle East. Then he said, I couldn't do a title like this unless I'm in contact with the two. And then he proceeded to tell us what's going on over there. We are blessed with a man directly from Almighty God, Allah. And I can agree with Brother Tommy on this. We have to be bearers of witness by being hearers of the word and doers of the word. I'm begging Almighty God Allah to help me do whatever I can do within the capacity of my soul to help this great man to give the people, and that's going to bear witness that I had an experience with the Almighty God Allah through the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. And I just want to say to our great brother Tommy, the minister is teaching us that we are reflections of Jesus, dear brother. It's not a mockery to say that the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan reflects Jesus. Because the scriptures say, let this mind be in you. The same mind that is in Christ Jesus, and he calls us joint heirs with Christ. So the minister is teaching us, we don't worship Jesus. We follow him so that we can reflect the same God that's in him that's manifesting and doing great works We have to reflect that same God and do those great works and bear witness to our Father, Almighty God, Allah in heaven. Thank you, family. And may Allah continue to bless us to do a great work on behalf of the Messiah and the great Messiah and God himself, that we may be bearers of witness with the departure, that we, in fact, know the presence of Almighty God, Allah. Assalamu alaikum.
Go ahead and teach, brother.
Wa alaikum salam. We're going to bring it now. Brother Student Minister Willie Muhammad from New Orleans, who I believe he got a testimony. Brother Willie?
Go ahead.
Go ahead.
Assalamu alaikum, my brothers. Can you hear me?
Wa alaikum salam.
Alaikum salam.
It was a fight, but we got you in here, man.
That's all right, brother. Listen, man, I don't normally, normally around this time I'll be asleep, but I said I got to resist my fatigue in order to be able to come on and share something for the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, who sacrifices for us. So this is an honor to be able to come on and be able to share a bit of my testimony. I don't know where to start, man, and how much time I have. But, you know, I will say this. You know, Brother Naba and Brother Murphy and our other brother James, listening to the brother talking, made me think about this, a quote that I've heard that Frederick Douglass had said, right? And Frederick Douglass said, it is easier to build strong children than to repair broken men. And when I thought about that statement as it relates to the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and the Nation of Islam, I thought about how the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, using the teachings of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, is evidence that broken men can be repaired. Because the minister has a track record of just doing that. All of us here who are on this call, most of these brothers that are calling in can bear witness, as the brother just did, Brother Daniel, of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan helping to change all of our lives. So I thank Almighty God Allah for the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan for his love, his charity, and everything. And I'll say this, and before I close, two things. And Brother Naba, you know about this. We talked about it via text recently. Look at the love of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, who is in Chicago, Illinois, but he heard about an 11-year-old girl who was charged with murder, first-degree murder. And the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan via Sister Starla sent message to me to ask that we go to New Iberia, which is 2 hours away from New Orleans, to find out the facts as best as we could about what this young sister was facing. And tomorrow is supposed to be the sentencing date. But look at the love of this man, that he is concerned about a young girl who he has never met that's hundreds of miles away from him. That's the love of the minister. We know the courage of the minister.
Right.
We know the sacrifice and the charity. And I'll say this. I was with the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan in Los Angeles maybe a couple of months before 10-10-15. And as we were sitting at the dinner table, I mentioned to the minister how a certain food I started eating after Katrina. And when I mentioned to him, the minister said, Katrina. He said, I said, oh, yes, sir, Brother Minister. The Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan had forgot, and he has never publicly said this. He forgot about the thousands of dollars of in aid that he wrote out of his personal account to aid families here in the city of New Orleans.
That's right.
The minister has never talked about that personally. But I bear witness because I was able to hand the checks to various believers. And then there's just that, and I'm closed on this part. I was at a documentary that we were participating in, and while there was a brother who was doing the security. His name is Michael White. He's a violinist here in the city of New Orleans. He told me how the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan and he met on a Tom Joyner cruise. And because of their love for the violin, they developed a relationship, and periodically he and the minister would have telephone calls. He said when Katrina hit, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan called him and offered for him and his family to come and live in the palace until they rebounded from Hurricane Katrina.
Mm.
And his brother said, remember the minister was asking
believers to open up our doors for those who were impacted by Katrina. And he was asking us to do something that himself was willing to do. And the brother right. said that he told the minister, he said, "Oh, brother minister, I can't accept that offer because, you know, I still like to run these streets and I don't want to be coming into your house late at night." He said, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan still paid for his rent in a apartment in Houston for a year. That's the, wow. And have we never heard the minister talk about that publicly?
Beautiful.
That's the heart of the man that we are following, right?
Very true. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Very true.
So thank you, Brother Willie, for that, brother.
Yes, sir. And thank you all for the opportunity, and may Allah continue to bless each and every one of you all.
Yes, sir. Thank you, brother.
I want to bring in now, Walaikum Salaam, our great sister, and a warrior for our people, man. Sister Beatrice X of the Love Not Blood campaign, which is devoted to now, check this out, working with, healing, serving, and servicing those who have lost loved ones to violence. My sister, are you there? Sister Beatrice, you there? We didn't lose her, did we? No, yes, somebody.
I don't think she...
We did.
Oh, we lost, okay.
Sister Beatrice.
Yes, sir, we lost.
Sister Beatrice, call back now. Call back. And you can get in, brothers and sisters. You still got time. 773-591-1690. In the meantime, since we devoted to defending Farrakhan, let me deal with something in the notoriously anti-black New York Post. They are now attacking Justice Department official Kristen Clark. She's being attacked by five Republican lawmakers. You know that Ms. Clark, our sister, is the Assistant Attorney General in the Department of Justice's Civil Rights Division. They're talking about outrage about the current environment at Columbia University. Interesting, they're not talking about Ole Miss while they were mocking our sister, a black woman, and some 300 white protesters came out to ridicule and intimidate 30 people, that were pro-Palestinian demonstrators standing up for ending genocide. They didn't talk about that, though. So they are now attacking our sister, and they are saying that they're angry because when she was president of the Harvard Student Association. Now imagine how many years that was, brothers and sisters. The late great scholar Tony Martin spoke, and sister lauded him for his scholarship. I'm going to stop there. Sister Beatrice, come on in, and we'll get back to defending Farrakhan once she finishes.
As-salamu alaykum.
The rest of y'all. Can you hear me? Alaykum salam. We can hear you.
Yay! I can hear y'all. Y'all just can hear me.
No joking.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
My sister.
And don't forget, growing up black in Phoenix, Arizona. We can't leave that out.
In Phoenix. That's right. Can't leave that out, Arizona.
not just right. Phoenix. Growing up black in Phoenix, Arizona. That's a whole other episode.
Now.
Okay. Yeah, so I want to just say, let me just say, my existence as who I am would not be if it wasn't for Master Farah Muhammad, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and our divine reminding our Mr. Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. I probably could not even get out of bed on most days if it was not for that reality. And that is just my truth. And it's a struggle. And Minister Farrakhan, to me, I love him so much because of his life and his sacrifice. I am nowhere near anywhere where he is. I'm striving every day to be upright in my being. It's a struggle every day. And if you are have an active soul that you're trying to save, like you're actually trying to save your soul and keep your spirit, it is a struggle every single day. For me, the biggest struggle is that struggle within myself. So I can go out and do the work that God has purposed me to do. With the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan at the top tier of how it's supposed to be done. I'm so far because, I don't know how he do it, because our people, oh my goodness. And when I get to there where I'm like, because listen, even in our database, unfortunately, of families impacted by police, we have like 1,000. Can we help all of them? No, we cannot. Do they expect us to? Yes, they do. Okay, so we do the best we can, but even in our community with our families, with our unsheltered families that I work with, you know, the struggle is so real. Without Master Farrakhan Muhammad, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and Mr. Farrakhan, I promise you, my life, I could not have a productive life with myself, with me being me, myself, and God. You know, no vices, no weed, no drinks, no. I would not be able to do that without the blessing of Allah coming for us, raising the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and in our divine Mr. Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. I personally, so my struggle every day is psychologically, mentally, spiritually. That's the number one work that I do. And then I go and do the work. Because if I can't get that right, and I would not have that right if I did not have the teachings and the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. And guess what? I'm still crazy, but I'm working on it. But I have the best tools. I have what we have the best that God has to offer to the whole universe. And so that's what I want to say about the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. I love him. I love him. And I time travel at night. He comes at the right time to tell me the right things all the time. This has been happening for years and years. And so I just want to say to the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, I am so grateful. God bless the womb, Allah bless the womb of your mother, and that you are still here with us to guide us. And please forgive us for our weakness. And, you know, I'm talking to myself, for our weakness and our struggle. But there is, you are the ring. You know, they get the golden ring. It's your spirit. It's the way that you live, and your dedication to Allah and your mission is what keeps me on the journey, trying to be in oneness with Allah. And I thank him. I can never, ever, ever, ever thank Allah enough for him being amongst us. Imagine where we are right now in this crazy world. And if the Honorable Elijah Muhammad wasn't telling the truth, and Minister Farrakhan wasn't true, and Master Farrakhan did not come, in this, where we at right now, in this time, as we walk, drive the streets every day and see the conditions of our people, see the minds of our people, and see how our people are really, can do some of the most atrocious things to each other, you know, and to see Satan at his highest height, because he's fighting for his life. He ain't trying to go nowhere. So to walk in this, but to know that Allah loves us so much, he's allowing the minister to stay here with us, you know, so that we can be rightly guided. So I'm from the west side. I ain't supposed to be crying. I'm crying. Okay, so let me stop it right there. Yes.
While you cry, sister, I want to just say this to you, and I don't know if you heard that I was here. This is Brother Jamil Muhammad, and I'm on the line to bear witness that you, your husband, your family, when I first moved to the Bay Area about 10 years ago, it was this family who opened their home to me before I could rent my apartment and do everything I needed to do. They opened their home in San Jose. One of their houses, the one in San Jose, opened it for me and made a way for me to get my foot in and begin doing all that I could to help in that community I want to say I love you, sister. I thank Allah for you, and I bear witness to the truth in your witness of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Thank you so much.
Assalamu alaikum. Thank you, Brother Jamil. You know we love you, too. And we love you. Thank you so much. And Brother Naba'a, yes, I love you, Brother Naba'a.
Oh, sister, we love you. Here's a greeting to your great husband. And F-O-I, Uncle Bobby. And F-O-I, don't forget that.
Yeah, F-O-I, Uncle mm-hmm. Bobby. Right. Don't forget F-O-I, Uncle Bobby. Okay?
That's right.
If I could, can I just share something, Brother Naba'a?
Go right ahead, sister.
First of all, my sister's 2-year anniversary just passed. And we out here giving them, we giving it to them. They are so tired of me and us and this fight. So they're so used to getting away with everything in Arizona, but not this time because Allah is the head of this fight. But I also wanted to share that on May 10th on Netflix, my sister-in-law, Wanda Johnson, with another mother whose son was beaten by police, Sister Ava, and I don't want to mess her name up, so y'all can say her name, the film producer. She bought the film, and it's going to air on Netflix. It is called For Our Children. So if everybody could tune in, that would be great. It's a great film about the struggle of mothers who've lost loved ones or have to fight this system who has killed their loved one or beaten their loved one, and they turn that pain into purpose. So it's on March the 10th on Netflix. Matter of fact, we'll be with the Sister Ava at her studio tomorrow in Los Angeles for a private screening of that. Our children.
Oh, you talking about Ava DuVernay?
DuVernay, yeah.
Yes, I am.
Okay, very good.
Yes, I am. So March 10th on Netflix, if everybody will tune in, that would be great.
And what's the name of the film again, sister?
For Our Children. It was done by a good friend of me and Uncle Bobby's that we met many years ago. She came from Brazil, and she came in, and she said she wanted to be a filmmaker, and she's so sweet. Her name is Deborah Silver, and then we introduced her to Wanda, and then she got a thing she wanted to do with the mothers, and she made this film. This film has been in the making a long time, and then Ava bought it, which is a blessing. So, you know,
she's
getting told our sister, Deborah Silver, she is getting to live her dream that she had when she came here from Brazil, barely speaking with broken up language, but now she's doing what she purposed to do, and it's a beautiful thing. And, of course, Wanda Johnson, her purpose as well.
And that's the mother of Oscar Grant.
Yes, it is.
Right? One of the first victims, brothers and sisters, whose killing was captured on cell phone video, which helped usher in this whole kind of incredible way of documenting police abuses, crimes, and even murders. Thank you, Sister Beatrice.
And thank you all. And thanks, great show. And we love you. And love you, love you, love you. Assalamu alaikum. And happy birthday, Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Happy, happy, happy birthday. May Allah bless you with many, many more.
Very good.
Assalamu alaikum.
Very good. All right. Very good. Let me see where we. So, brothers and sisters, you still got time. 773-591-1690. Let's bring in Brother Scott. Brother Scott from Tuskegee.
Tuskegee. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Wa alaikum salam, my brother.
The floor is yours,
my brother. How's everyone?
Great.
Oh, wonderful. Brother, thank you for inviting us on to bear witness. Thank you, brother. How are you all this evening?
All praise to Allah. Doing great.
Praise to Allah. Yes.
Praise due to Allah. That was a beautiful testimony from my sister. I heard her film For Our Children. I said, man, we got to put that in our film festival. Yes, sir. So, for me, what the show made me think about in terms of what the minister means to me, you know, which You know, I would have to start out by saying, you know, just from the age of 17, his voice has been the dominant force in my life. So my whole adult life, I'm now 51, and just his voice and the sound of it has been the impetus, the catalyst for everything of substance that I encounter and that I do. And when I think about his meaning, I had a recent epiphany. When in 2013, we invited the minister down to Tuskegee, and we had, you know, the initial invitation was for him to come down to the school on a Thursday evening, and I wanted to show the World Friendship Tour to Tuskegee, and I wanted him to sit in the audience, because we have been screening the film at different film festivals, and we had shown it multiple times in our own film festival, the Selma Jubilee, during the Bridge Crossing Jubilee. It's the largest event dealing with civil rights and dealing with Black history in the South. And when I would show this film, you know, it would just blow audiences away. You would see people in the audience crying, watching him travel around the world and meeting with all of those who mean something to us, and watching the people. I mean, that film, that documentary is so beautifully well made. You know, you just can't overstate it or overemphasize it. That is just from a technical or production space, that is a beautifully made film. So I wanted to show it to the Tuskegee University audience, and I wanted the minister to experience what we have been experiencing when we show this film and seeing these audiences. And so we sent in our invitation for him to come on a Thursday, but I don't think the invitation was really read, you know, because he gets a lot of invitations. So it was just like, okay, this is from Tuskegee University. Tell them that we'll be down on Friday and we'll leave on Saturday. And when I got that message, I, you know, responded back and said, well, we didn't ask for him to come on Friday and do a lecture. If he can do a lecture, that's fine. We asked him to come on Thursday, and we want, because that's when all the students are going to be here, and we want him to sit in the audience, and we want him to see this film, and at the end of the film, we would like him to take questions. And so that began the process. Well, why? Right? They're asking why. So I had to rewrite everything in, and, you know, I was learning how to do geopolitical analysis, and when I was given my reason, you know, I think I gave a reason along the lines of the impact of the Million Man March and him becoming the deputy director of a Muslim organization that had the Muslim nations of the world attending, and he's the deputy director. And we just kind of saw that having something to do with the rise of Osama bin Laden to counter his approach, which had largely been nonviolent. You know, the way he moves through the principles of the Bible and the Quran. So I'm giving all of this reason, and the minister instructed them to write me back and said he will be coming down on a Wednesday and he'll leave on Saturday, which meant we have 4 days. And I'm just reflecting. I had the minister's itinerary. We built his whole itinerary for the entire time that he was in Tuskegee. And I'm going to jump forward a little bit. We had the meeting. The minister came, the mayor of the city came, other dignitaries came, and we were in the historic chapel of Tuskegee, a building built by the hands of those fresh off the plantation, not only built and designed by Robert Taylor, who the Robert Taylor Homes were named after. He was an architect on the campus. He designed the campus, and he designed this building, and the brothers, fresh out of slavery, not only built the building, they dug up the clay, built the kiln, and baked the bricks that made this building. And so we're in this building, and we're showing the World Friendship Tour, and the students, and the faculty, and the staff, and everybody's just blown away seeing our minister travel around the world, you know? And I believe it was probably the next day I was blessed to be sitting in his room with him, and it was just he and I. And he asked me, he said, "Brother, tell me again, why did you want me to do, you know, sit and watch the World Friendship Tour?" And I started on this geopolitical analysis thing. He said, "Oh, okay, all right." And he moved it along. And I said, "Well, I was wondering what that was about." And it struck me recently, really, what the profundity of his coming down meant, right? What that whole scenario, what the importance of it was. And it happened during Ramadan. I was, you know, reading like everybody else, and I was at the section where we were reading about, you know, and Noah was sent, and Lot was sent, and, you know, Saleh was sent, you know, all of these messengers, all of these prophets were sent to the people of their land. And, of course, the leadership gave the lie to their words, but all of the prophets were sent to a particular people. But here we were blessed with one who had went to all the nations of the world. He is the warner for all nations. Everybody else just went to a particular people. And this one went to Hud, and that one went, you know, Saleh went to whatever land was. I can't even, it's late. I can't remember it right now. But everybody had went to a specific land. Our minister went all over the world. And it just, it really dawned on me, you know, what that moment in Tuskegee is really representing. Because he came on a Wednesday, we had a presidential reception for the minister at the president of the university mansion. And we had asked him to assemble all of the top deans and scientists from around the school. Well, it just so happened that all the top deans and scientists were from all over the world, and most of them were Muslim. All of the deans of all of the colleges and all of these scientists with their own labs, and the ones who were doing the top research, bringing them millions of dollars a year in research dollars, most of them were Muslims. And when we sat down with the president of the university, it was so intriguing. The first thing he did was he asked the minister, he said, "Brother Farrakhan," he said, "you know, black people are not doing clinical trials because of the reputation of the Tuskegee experiment and others. And we have those of our leadership who go out and they teach, and the people hear it, and now they don't trust clinical trials. And so when the new medications are being made, when the new procedures are being made, they're based on information that the scientists and experiments that they're doing with white people, and we're falling behind because nothing is really geared towards us, and it's hurting the science. And we want to know, you know, what we're going to do about that." And it really put Minister kind of on the spot. You know, here we are in this beautiful mansion, sitting at the president's table, all of the president's staff sitting around, and he asked the minister that question. And I was sitting there, and I was thinking, man, how's the minister going to really, like, handle this? And the minister smiled and said, "Well, brother, we don't want to hurt the science." And then he looked across the room, and he said, "Excuse me, sir, where are you from?" And that brother happened to be from Harare, Muslim, I believe. And the minister said, "Oh, I was just there with your president. Do you know that the top
industry in your country is casket making, and we were talking with your Minister of Health, and they told us that everybody had been vaccinated. I mean, and it just blew the lid off of the whole thing, and it was like, you could not have known that. You couldn't. That wasn't just brilliant. That was the communication of Allah with his servant in real time, and we witnessed it. How do you know to look across the room and choose that particular person? And that's the cascade, because then it was like it was just going around the room. And where are you from? Oh, I'm from here. Oh, I was just there with your president. Oh, I was just there with your prime minister. Oh, I was just there with the head of your banking industry. A warner for all nations. And you can see a clip of that dinner on YouTube if you put in Farrakhan and Tuskegee. And because they didn't let us film, I remember Brother Joshua was filming, and we had a brother here who was also filming, and the first lady of the university, she came and asked if they stopped filming while we were eating, because she did not want the optics, you know, possibly bad optics of somebody chewing and you're filming, so they had to shut the cameras off. So that part was not on film, but the minister's statement was profound, because one of the first things he said, you know, I believe this trip is a turning point in my life. And I'm sitting at the table with him, I'm looking at him saying, but he's 80. Wow, what's really happening here? But we were seeing the emergence, you know, the coming together of this man who is a warner, not just America. He is a warner for all the nations. And we saw it at Savior's Day. And he's still not done, you know. So what he means to us, you know, depending on where we are in the space of our life, is one thing, and it's no doubt profound. It's no doubt just, you know, like, goes to the core of us. But who he really is, I think, is still unfolding. And what he really means to us is still unfolding. Do you know this man is about to free the entire world? He's in the process. Allah is using him to free the whole world of Satan's touch, because he's exposing Satan. So the whole world is seeing Satan, but then their whole world is going to be free of Satan. So he's the helper of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, who is going to help us to have not just freedom, but a full and complete freedom. Because as long as Satan is on the loose, and as long as Satan is in the world, and as long as Satan is unknown, you can't have freedom. Everything you have to have some kind of security mechanism, because Satan can come along and kill, steal, and destroy it, right? But once Satan is removed, then we can begin to experience not just freedom to, but freedom from. And that's that full and complete freedom, I believe, that we're due, at least on one level. You know, it never ceases to go deeper and broader, you know, so I just wanted to say, you know, to bear witness in that way, that, you know, it's like I don't have the what I need to really put it in words in this moment, but it hit me like a hammer. It's like, oh, my God, he was trying to get me to see. I'm over here trying to do something smart. Oh, see, and Osama bin Laden, geopolitical analysis. My master now. Read your Quran. Let it say all these prophets went to one place. This man went all over the world, and everywhere he went, the crowds came out. Some, like when he spoke in Iran, to millions during their revolution, but there were tens and thousands of people coming, and all of them were bearing witness to who he was.
We had one for all nations with us, and I just want to encourage us now in the fourth quarter when we're battling and everybody's scarred up and tired. Man, it's time now, y'all. Let's run this last leg of the race for all of our children in perpetuity. Leave everything on the field, y'all. It's our moment.
Go ahead, brother.
Well, I thank you for allowing me to share these words. And I really appreciate you, Brother Nob, and everything you're doing. And we're going to be calling you for our upcoming event. I don't want to say much on that now because we're still pulling it together. And before it's all pulled together, we'll be calling you so that you can determine how you would like to fit in. But we're very thankful for what you're doing, beloved. May Allah bless you and strengthen you to continue.
Brother Scott, beautiful. Thank you. May Allah bless you and to continue the great work that you're doing in the great city of Tuskegee. Thank you. Brother Jamil Muhammad has been with us for a while. He's had a very long day. It's midnight here almost, so it's like 1 in the morning.
That's
he's
right.
Got a radio show that he does. So, Brother Minister, Student Minister Jamil, we're going to properly relieve you, sir. And thank you for your sacrifice and your spirit.
Yes, sir.
And your witness bearing.
That's right.
All praise is due to Allah. I am honored to have been here this evening, brothers. Thank you for your consideration and for your allowing me to be a part of this wonderful exercise in witness bearing. I, too, like you, am proud that I was born black and I've grown strong and I'm praying that I'll always be unapologetically
All right.
Go ahead.
May Allah bless you. Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam. All right. Well, brothers, let's let Sister Tawan come on in. Sister Tawan, come on from the East Coast. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum. I just wanted to say I am so grateful to be here where I can say blessed anniversary to the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan and to thank him for his work and him producing brothers like all of you, like Brother Jamil and Brother Scott and Sister Beatrix, the sisters, and I mean, I am just so grateful. I don't have my only testimony is that I'm grateful to be living in this time and to be able to say that I am a member of the greatest nation. I am a citizen of the nation of Islam, the nation of God, the nation of God, and be in the midst of the Messiah. I mean, I read in the scriptures about the time of the Messiah and living in that time and woke up one day years ago and say, oh my God, we're living in this right now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and to see this, and I just want to say, I can't remember because I almost wasn't going to say this because I couldn't. My recall tonight, you know, it's like 1 o'clock in the morning, the date of the Savior's Day, but I remember it was in the 90s. The Minister Farrakhan, he had on green, and he looked at us and he said, close your eyes. And when I say Jesus, tell me what you see. Open your eyes. What did you see?
Mm-hmm.
You know, he didn't ask you what, you know, he said, now what did you see? But he wanted us to close our eyes. And what? And I Allah's my witness, I saw him.
Mm-hmm.
And when we went back to the hotel room, you know, we used to go to lots of sisters in a room, and I was like, you know, people didn't want to share what they saw. So I didn't share what I saw because I didn't want, you know, but I saw him, and then I did share it with somebody, and they said, oh, well, you got to be responsible for that. That makes you responsible. And I was like, oh, okay. I didn't understand what that meant then, but as I'm growing and developing, and the only thing I can say is that I'm a sister, and I'm striving hard to be a sister. And you know, this is an army, and we have an army, and we're all soldiers, and that means we're but we have a volunteer army, and we have volunteers. The only thing I want to do is I want to be like the operation person in a disaster, and you take care of the volunteers. And if I can't do anything but give you a kind word or send you an emoji or a text or anything, that's the best I can do right now, and that's what I have to offer. But I'm grateful that Allah gave me a man to show me that that was value, that has value too. So I thank Allah for the honorable Mr. Farrakhan. I thank you all. Thank you, Brother Naba, from the bottom of my heart for having this platform for our people who are the soldiers out there on the ground doing the work for freedom, justice, and equality for our people. And they have a platform now, a refuge, where they can come and lay their work out and tell us what's going on and what they're doing. And you gave them and you all are there for them every week to encourage them. And I thank you all. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
For letting me be. Assalamu alaikum. Well, thank you for your support and everything. Brothers, with your indulgence, I'm going to take 2 minutes, if you don't mind.
Yes, sir.
Because I want to deal with this anti-black New York Post. This, you have now entered the defending Farrakhan aspect of this broadcast. So now, according to the Post, you've got 5 lawmakers, 5 Republicans, that are now launched an attack against Kristen Clark, the black woman who is the Assistant Attorney General in the Department of Justice Civil Rights Division, to express their outrage about the current environment at Columbia University and demand that she disavow her extensive connections to well-known anti-Semites, right? According to a letter exclusively obtained by the Post. That means somebody, they gave her the letter. Mm-hmm. Interesting. Mm-hmm. You want to accuse our sister of being associated with anti-Semites when you certainly are associated with anti-black people. Trump is certainly anti-black. Throughout your party, it is the rejection of blackness that brings you electoral success. And state legislatures across the country, you and your party have directed your anti-black hatred and activity against us to blunt our ability to practice the voting rights that you say that we should have as American citizens. You have refused, your party has refused to enact federal police reform. You and your party have refused even to pass the John Lewis Voting Rights Act, but that wasn't really your fault because it was the weak Joe Biden and the Democrats who had the majority that didn't do their job. But you are still a co-conspirator in trying to deprive our people of any measure of justice and any measure of success. But yet you would dare stand before the world and say that America is a great democracy. America is no such thing as she never has been. Just like Kristen Clark has never been an anti-Semite. Years ago when she was at Howard, according to this article, she had the great scholar Tony Martin speak, and he talked about the Jewish onslaught. He talked about the Jewish involvement in the slave trade and other aspects of their history that ill affected black people. That's not anti-Semitism, that's just truth. If you have someone telling a lie, to counteract the lie, all you simply do is tell the truth. You ever call this sister an anti-Semite because she's associated with Tamika Mallory and Linda Sarsour? Neither one of them are that. They never have been. Never. But because they have been in the presence of and in some way worked with Minister Farrakhan,
to help deliver our suffering people who you hate, GOP leaders. You don't want to see us get anything. You have the old mindset that we should be destroyed. But you're living in the wrong time and in the wrong day, because we will certainly go free. Allah God has promised us that, and your country is falling apart. Or as our dear minister said, it is the unraveling of a great nation. You're fighting and slaughtering one another. Right now it's verbal. Right now it's philosophical. But you've got Americans who believe that it will soon be physical, that a civil war is coming. What will you do then? Our minister has never been an anti-Semite. How dare you, with all the blood on your hands? How dare you, with your history of double dealing, deception, stealing, lying, and murdering our people and the darker people of the earth? How dare you call a righteous name man by such an unrighteous name? It is because the sins that you try to attribute to him are your sins, because you are anti-black. The minister has said, and I quote, he did say at a speech in Detroit, I'm not an anti-Semite, I'm anti-termite. But what you did not do, because you are a liar and a deceiver, you did not add the other part to what he said, which was, I don't know anything about hating someone because of their religion. You won't tell the truth, because right. You are of the devil. So I'm going to close with that and say that we stand with Farrakhan, and we will be the winner. So you can put that in your pipe and smoke it. But BJ, get us out of here, man.
Go ahead, brother. Nice peace, brother James G, brother Naba'a Richard Muhammad. Thank y'all for joining us, brothers and sisters. We will be back with you on next Tuesday. We're the will of Almighty God, Allah, from 9 p.m. until midnight. Don't forget, you can support us. Go to straightwords.com, our website, and check out all of our on-demand content that we produce every week for you. Straight Words on Cash App, $StraightWords on Cash App. Donate tonight, 312-480-9775 on Zelle, 312-480-9775 on Zelle, and on PayPal, straightwords4@gmail.com. Brothers and sisters, the scripture says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Go out and spread peace all over the city of Chicago and everywhere you are. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum.
Of Chicago and the voice of the nation is 1690 WVON, Berwyn, Chicago.
Preventive health works. That's why regular health exams and tests are highly recommended to help find problems before they start. Schedule an appointment with your doctor today. That's your healthy reminder.
Hey, Alexa. Play WVON 1690 AM.
Getting WVON 1690 AM station from iHeartRadio.
Try it out for yourself. America is listening to WVON.
You've worked hard and paid into Social Security, but if Congress doesn't take action within 10 years, the Social Security you've earned could be cut by 20%. Join AARP Illinois for a special live radio event on protecting Social Security, hosted by Robin Robinson. Tune in to WVON 1690 AM for Conversations with Chicago Leaders, a virtual discussion about building wealth and the future of